Good morning, dear students. Welcome back to your business studies class. Now we are doing chapter number 2, forms of business organization. So before moving on to today's topic, I would give you a quick recap of what we have done so far. So see, in the forms of business organization, you have seen that there are mainly two forms of business organization. One is the non-corporate enterprise and one is the corporate enterprise. In the non-corporate enterprise, it is further of three types, wherein yesterday we covered about sole proprietorship and today we are going to touch about joint Hindu family business. So see, sole proprietorship, you have understood that it is a single owner, because sole means only and owner means a single owner. So in single individual. So sole proprietor simply means wherein you have one owner, and all the limitations, all the features and all the disadvantages we have done, wherein we have seen he has unlimited liability, he is the sole bearer of the risk, he gets the profit totally himself, he has limited managerial abilities. So all these features, merits, demerits, we have already covered. Now today we shall cover about joint Hindu family business, its merits, demerits, everything. So let us see what joint Hindu family business is. So just see, the joint Hindu family business means the business owned by the members of a joint Hindu family. See, what happens is, many a times we have joint Hindu families wherein all the family members, 4 or 5 brothers are there, the grandfather and the grandmother is there, and all the 4 brothers are living together. They have their individual wives who are living together, and then they also have their kids. So this is a sort of business wherein all the family are part of the business. So it is the oldest form of business that we can see in India. Okay, this is the business which is the oldest form and we can see in India. And this type of business is very, you know, common. Many people have this, and they have a trend that every one of the family will join the same business. So this is what is joint Hindu family business. Next, you see, it is governed by the provisions of the Hindu law. That means you have some laws made by the Hindu law. On the basis of those laws, the things are governed, the provisions are made. So the basis of the membership in the business is by birth. Means the moment you have a birth in that particular family, then you have the right to do the business. And generally 3 successive generations can be the member. That means suppose you have your grandfather, then your father, and then you people. So if your grandfathers are 4 or 5 brothers, they will also be part of it. If your father and buas are all 4 or 5 brothers and sisters, they will also be a part of it. Same way, if you are 3 or 5 of your siblings, all of you will be the part of the business. So up to 3 generations, generally they allow you to have the membership. Okay, moving to the next one, the business is controlled by the head of the family, who is the oldest member, eldest member, and is also known as Karta. That means in Hindu joint family, the business is totally controlled by the head member, who is generally the eldest of all. Okay, who is the oldest one, that is considered as the Karta. And he is the main head, as the name says Karta, so he is the Karta Dharta. So all the members, the male and the female, have equal ownership right over the property of the ancestors, and they are known as the co-parsoners. That means, co-parsoners means all the members, be it male, be it female. Earlier we had only male members as the, you know, having the ownership right. But with the succession, with the change in the law, now we have all the members, be it male, be it female. All the members have the ownership right when the moment they are having birth in the family. So they are known as co-parsoners. Please remember this word. The partners are known as co-parsoners. So the business is controlled by the head of the family and all other members are co-parsoners. Understood what the meaning of joint Hindu family business is? Now let us move towards the features of the joint Hindu family business. Means what are the various characteristics or features of this sort of business? So see the first slide, what we have. Formation. It means minimum 2 members of the family and their ancestral property is used for the business. At least you should have 2 members who will join the business, and you should be having some ancestral property, means some property which is of your dada and pradada. So some ancestral property or business has to be there. So it is governed by the Hindu Succession Act 1956. Please remember, you have a proper act for this, which is Hindu Succession Act 1956. According to this, the formation of the business can be done if you have minimum 2 members and some ancestral properties along with you. So formation is very easy. Next, moving to the second point, we have liability. So see this point, liability is the liability of the members of the other partners have unlimited liability, but that of the Karta is other members have limited liability, but that of the Karta is unlimited. Please remember this and understand this, that the liability of the Karta is unlimited. but that of all the members is limited. Means Karta is the head and everything, so he has unlimited liability. If anything happens, he has to bear everything. But other members have a limited liability to the extent of the share that they are having in the business. Suppose there are 10 brothers, so 10 of them might be having 10% share, na? So they will have the liability up to a limited extent as per their part in the profit, as per their part in everything. But the head has unlimited liability. That means the liability of the Karta is unlimited. He bears everything. He is the main person who is responsible for everything. Understood? Moving to the third one, we have control. That means management is vested in the hands of the Karta. Karta is the main Karta Dharta. So he has the whole control over the business. No doubt the other members are also considered. They are being also asked about the opinion. But ultimately the main control and the decision will be of the Karta. So the Karta has the sole control over the business. And others has to follow what he is deciding. So he has the whole control in his hands. Understood? Moving to the fourth one, we have continuity. That means the death of the member or a Karta does not affect the business. But in sole proprietorship, you have read that continuity is not there. If the sole proprietor dies, the business comes to an end. But here you have that if the Karta dies, or if the Karta dies, the other who is the next head of the family, who is the next, you know, eldest member, he or she will become the Karta. Understood? But the death will not affect the business. The business will still continue. After, you know, the person has died, the other members are still the members and everything will go on the same way. Understood? Moving to the next one, we have minor members. Minor means the kids, the siblings, the small children. So they have the right to the business by birth. Means they get automatically becomes a member by birth. If suppose my child has taken birth, he is just 6 months old, but by default, he also becomes a member of the joint Hindu family business. So if we would be having any business with our ancestors, you know, who is it has been going on since generations after generation. So my son will automatically become the member of this joint Hindu family business. So the moment you take birth in that family, you become the member of the business. Understood? And moving to the last one, we have both male and female members in the family have equal right in the business based on the Hindu Succession Amendment Act 2005. See, the act was made in 1956. But then the amendment was made in 2005. There were some changes. I told you earlier there was only the male member having the right. But then when the female also, now we say na, we have equal right over the birth. The male and the female both have the right to the property of their fathers and mothers. So now with the Amendment Act in 2005, both male and the female members are having the equal right in the business. Now the sons cannot deny that it is you have got married, so nothing is of you. I marry or I don't marry, I have an equal right over my father's property. Understood? So this is what is joint Hindu family business all about. Now, let us move towards the merits of the joint Hindu family business. So see what are the merits of the joint Hindu family business. The first merit is effective control. It means what? No conflict among members as the decisions are to be taken by the Karta. There is total control of the Karta. So there is no conflict among the members. Suppose me, my brother, my sister, we will not fight because the ultimate decision will be taken over by the Karta. No doubt we can opine our suggestions to him. We can give him opinions. But ultimately he is the main Karta Dharta. He is having the main control. So there will be no conflict among the members. I cannot fight, you know, because I know my brother is not doing anything. Ultimately it is my father who is taking the decision. So I have no control over it. So the whole control is on the hands of the Karta. Moving to the second point, we have continued existence. It means what? Even the death of the Karta will not affect the business existence. The business will go on to the next eldest member's hand and he will become the Karta. He will take up the position. So the business continues. But see, this was again a demerit in the sole proprietorship, that when the sole proprietor dies, his business also discontinues. It comes to an end. But here it is again a merit that if the Karta dies or if any other members dies, the business is not affecting. The business will still go on. The next eldest member will become the Karta. He will start taking the decisions on behalf of the whole business. And then the business will go on in the same way as it was going on earlier. Moving to the third point, we have limited liability. I told you again, the liability of the partners are limited, but that of the Karta is unlimited. So see again, in the sole proprietorship, you had unlimited liability. But here you have that everyone as a member have limited liability. Their liabilities are limited to the extent that they are working for. And the Karta has unlimited liability. He is ultimately the head whose liability is unlimited. Understood the third point? Moving to the next point, we have increased loyalty and cooperation means the business is treated as a pride to the family. So the, you know, loyalty is being increased. Cooperation among the members is increasing. Obviously, if I have seen that my this business is running on since 20-25 years, so obviously, and it is earning a very good amount, I'll be loyal to my business, I'll be loyal to my brothers. Why will I cheat? Why will I not cooperate with them? Because it is a matter of goodwill. It is a matter of pride for us. So if the business still continues, we will obviously be proud. And why not if our next generation, generation after generation carries on with the same brand, the same logo, the same business. So it is a moment of pride for the family. So there increases the loyalty and the cooperation among all the members. They do not fight. There is a loyalty amongst them. Understood what are the merits of the joint Hindu family business? Now we move towards the demerits or the limitations of joint Hindu family business. See, every business has some limitations. So let us see what limitations we have for joint Hindu family business. The first limitation that we have is limited resource. That means the resources are limited. Now ultimately there is a one business and one family. So it depends mainly on the ancestral property, how much of property you have. If you have a very good business, lot of things and everything, then it is okay. But if you are having a limited source, market structure is not good, there is an up and down, inflation, deflation in the market. So sometimes you may suffer also. Because ultimately every one of you are in the same business. So how much of money will you be able to bring? Sometimes there may be that you don't have money. You have projects, you have everything in your mind, but you don't have money. So limited resource is a drawback of this JHF. That means joint Hindu family business sometimes does not have that much of resources with them so that they can invest in the business. Understood? Moving to the second point, we have unlimited liability of the karta. Now see about the karta's point of view. His liability is unlimited. Everyone is eating. Everyone is having the fruit. But he is ultimately the head and his liability is unlimited. He or she is even liable to pay from the personal property if he has to meet the debt of the firm. See, if the karta is the head, that he might have to, or he, she might have to bring the personal jewelry or personal anything to pay the debt of the firm. Other members will not bring, but the karta has to bring. Because the karta is enjoying some advantages also. So he has some drawbacks also. He has to bring his personal money. He has to bring his property and then give the debt of the business. Understood? Moving to the third point, we have dominance of the karta. Sometimes what happens, a feeling comes to the member that what is this? Every decision has to be taken by the karta. Sometimes his decisions may be wrong. So the leadership quality of the karta may not be acceptable by all the family members. Sometimes the family is not accepting, which may result to even in the breakdown of the family. Sometimes they may be separated also. The business might also come to an end or any sort of things can happen. So the dominant power, the dominating nature of the karta is again a drawback or a limitations of this family business. Maybe sometimes the other members doesn't like it. So there exists, you know, some kind of conspiracy and then there is some difference between the family members and slowly and steadily the business comes to an end. Understood about dominance of karta? Moving to the next one, we have the fourth point and the last point, limited managerial skill. Now see, the karta may not be an expert in all the areas of the management. Now, if he is not an expert and if he is a very rigid karta, he is not taking advice from any other member. So, because of his limited managerial abilities and skill, it might lead to loss of the business. And when there is a loss of the business might come to an end. So, this is again a drawback that sometimes the managerial skills and ability in the hands of the karta are not that much. Karta is not having that much of capacity and that much of thing with him because of which, you know, the whole business. So these were in short, you have read about the meaning of the joint Hindu family business, the features of the JHF, the limitations, the merits and the demerits. Understood? Please jot down that in your copies. And today I just also explain you what partnership is and what are the features of partnership. That's it. So two more topic for today and then it's over. So see, let's move to what partnership is. Let us see what partnership means. So partnership is a form of business organization emerged to overcome the difficulties of the sole proprietorship business. See what happens in a sole proprietor, there is a single owner. How much of capital can he bring? He might not be expert in all the, he might not have all the skills. He might not be expert in all the areas. He is the sole risk bearer. So a lot of things were there where we found that the business cannot run. Plus we saw now that there was since limited capital, so the size of the business could be small. Now, if someone wants to open a big multinational company, but he obviously being a sole proprietor doesn't have that much of money. So why not you and me together form a business wherein both of us are giving our money, both of us are working together. So bole na ek se bhale do, obviously one two is better than one. So why not two or three join hands together to do the business, and then that business is known as partnership business. Understood? See the next slide. What we have, definition of partnership according to the Partnership Act 1932 says that, a very important definition, and the act of the partnership, Indian Partnership Act, is Partnership Act 1932. Please remember the years. So the relationship between people or person who have agreed to share the profits of the business, carried on by all or any of them acting for all. Very important definition. When two or more people, they have agreed to share the profits. See, the profit will not be in the hands of one. So obviously they will share the profits. So when they have decided to share the profits of the business, either carried on by all, that means the business is either carried on by everyone or any of them acting for all. Sometimes it may happen that I have money, but I don't have time. So I am doing what? Suppose I and my brother are having money and we started a partnership business. Now I am giving him the money, but I am saying that I'll be a sort of sleeping partner. Means I will not come and look into the business. Everything you take care of. Profits will be there, I'll take part. Loss will be there, I'll take part. But I'm a sleeping partner, means a side partner. So then it comes that any of them acting for all. That means he is acting for both of us. So either all of them will work or any of them will work for all. Understood? Now let us go towards the features of the partnership, the last topic of this day. So see what features we have. First feature is formation. The formation is completely based on the agreement among the partners. We must have an agreement which is law, which should be a lawful business, and it may be either oral or written. Means the agreement that I will make with my brother, it could be an oral agreement or verbally, or it could be a written one. But obviously remember, written ones are always considered to be a better one because it acts as a proof one. Oral, tomorrow he may deny that I have not given 5 lakh rupees in the business. I may deny that I have not given the 10 lakh. I may say I have given 10 lakh in the business, though I might have given only 2 lakh in the business. So a lot of conflicts come when it is a matter of oral deed, you know. So always it is said that whenever you make an agreement with your partner, make it a written one so that it acts as a proof. Okay, but two people coming together for a charitable purpose is not a business. Remember that if two people are coming and doing charity, that's not a business. The motive should be earning profit. But if you're doing and helping people, your motive is not your profit. Your motive is charity. Then you are not running a business. So understood what formation is. Moving to the second feature, we have liability. So the liability of each partner is unlimited. That means me and my partner both have unlimited liability. We might have to bring our personal property and give if the business is suffering a loss or debt is there. Lot of udhars are there, lot of people has to be given money and the business is running in a loss. Then my partner and me, both of us has to sell our personal properties and ultimately give the money to the business. Understood? So the liability of both the partner is unlimited. Moving to the third point, we have risk bearing. Now all the risk and the loss again is shared by all the partner. Why will he has all the risk or why will I have all the risk? Both of us will have the risk according to the share of profit we are having. If my share of profit is two, his two portions, his share of profit is one portion, then I'll take the share more risk, he will share less risk. If both of us are equal partner, then both of us will share the risk equally. So ultimately the risk is shared by both the partners, or if there are multiple partners, then all the partners. It is not lying in the hand of one partner. Understood? Moving to the next one, we have decision making and control. Now again, decisions are generally taken by mutual consent. If we both are partners, only I taking the decision or only he taking the decision will not do. We have to sit together, talk about the matter, take the decision mutually. It should benefit us. If I am denying, he cannot then go for that business. Suppose the project is there but I am denying, then he cannot go. Same way, if a project is there and he is agreeing, then I cannot go. So both of us should have the decisions mutually agreed. Understood? So control and decision making lies in the hand of both the partners or multiple partners. Understood? Moving to the next one, we have continuity. That means a business is purely an organization and there is a separate legal existence apart from the members. Hence, it lacks continuity. See, what happens is I and my partner and our business are all different members. Means we have separate legal existence. But you remember in sole proprietorship, you read that there is no separate legal existence. Means me and my business are the same people. If anything happens to the business, I am liable to pay. But here, the continuity is not there. That means if I and my brother are partners and our business is there, suppose AB Enterprise, then I, my brother and the AB Enterprise are all separate legal entities. They are all separate. So death, insanity, etc. of a partner bring an end to the business. if I die, then obviously our business will come to an end. Or if my partner dies, obviously the business will come to an end. That is why the continuity is not there. Understood this point? Moving to the next point, we have membership. That means the minimum member required is 2. At least 2 members should be there to start a partnership business. According to the section 464 of Companies Act 2013, maximum number of partners can be 100, subject to that the number preceded by the government. Baki, it depends. Sometimes the government restricts that, okay, you cannot have more than this much members. So the membership numbers depend from 2 to 50 or, you know, anything. So the number might differ. Maximum number could be 100, minimum could be 2. It could be anything between 2 to 100. So at present, it is limited to 50 by the government. Government is at present fixing it 50. But then ultimately maximum can be 100. But then you have to ask the government before starting that sort of partnership business. So the maximum number is 50, minimum is 2. But for some businesses, the maximum number could be 100. I repeat again, the minimum number is 2, the maximum number is 50. But some businesses may have the maximum number up to 100. That depends on government, if they are prescribing that. Understood? See, the last point of the partnership, mutual agency. Mutual agency means that ultimately, each partner is an agent and the other partner as well as in the firm. It means every partner is an agent also and a worker also. We both are working together and then we both mutually agree to work together as well as for the firm. So we are partners and we are working for ourselves and also for our firm. So he's an agent for the firm. Understood what are the features of the partnership? So please go through all these things which I have done today. I just cover up the features today because we have a lot of things in the partnership. So I have taken 2 parts today so that it will not be a troublesome tomorrow. Because in partnership, you don't only have features, merits and demerits. Some more points you will learn about in this. So please go through all these. This chapter partnership which we are doing will again come in your class 12. So read it properly. It will really help you a lot if you focus over here in class 11. Jot down all the points in your notebooks and submit to me the work. Thank you. Have a nice day.